morning, everyone. I would like to thank Arun for a gentle introduction and also Mr. Girish for having a good introduction to WhatsApp, because it's going to be helpful in our this session. So I will be taking R and spatial data. So as you have seen that R gives a powerful way of handling the data. The traditional GIS softwares which we are using, ArcGIS, QGIS, they work with spatial databases, and somehow they lack the ability to create some inferences, to provide some inferences from the database what we have. The big approach is that we have a data, we have geological data, we have location attached to it, but the thing is that we want to get more insights which cannot be given from the spatial databases. So that's where the R comes into handy. What you have is all the data is there, it's a static data. All you need is apply some machine learning algorithms which cannot be done on spatial data and spatial data softwares like ArcGIS. So I will be sharing this tutorial, the lecture notes you will be having after the workshop or maybe after the day. But because of the short of time, I will be taking the important points over this. I'm using RStudio, it's a R notebook similar to Jupyter notebook, and all these are just description about it, and we will be looking at the cells in this. So right now I have this shapefiles. Shapefiles comes in multiple formats. It's not a single thing, it's at a attribute data, it's as a shape defines in the vector and raster data. So while defining the raster data in spatial data, the vector data is representing to the coordinates. So your location data, the points are vector data. The raster data are the continuous points. So for example, you are having a temperature data. So temperature can vary from point to point. So you make grid of it, you plot it in the terms of grid. Grid could be large, could be small. So that's where the raster data comes into the picture, and the vector data is all about boundaries. So I can have a point, I can connect those points and form a line, and I can form a closed loop and it will form a polygon. So that's all about my states file. So state shape file, you can use it in normal GIS software, but for data attributes file, we have a states.dbf file. So just we will have a look at this, what it is all about. It can be opened with normal Excel file, dbf file. So let's just have a look at this. So I have created a simple thing. It is just a state name. So this shapefile contains the political bond maps states of India with the state's name. You can have additional data like your population in these states. And as we will go with this tutorial, I will try to add the data of the accidental data in this attributes. But it is not in the actual data. We will do it in the R. So here I will have this. First load this thing. States.shapefile. It will give that it has 36 features and one fields. So 36 features, just to have a look at this, what this contains. This is where RStudio comes into the handy. You can see it directly in this global environment thing, and its states. So these are the data in this. This is how our shapefile is loaded. Yep, here we are reading the state shape file, and state shape file will have this. So data will have some state name because it's already loaded. So there are some extra attributes also. So just because I'm short of time, so I will not going to rerun everything. You will have this polygon data. So because we have 28 states and 29 states and 7 union territories, avoiding the Jammu Kashmir right now, it's a little old data. So it will have 36 polygons. Then you have plot order, you have boundary box, because every spatial data needs to have a boundary. It's like you are viewing India map, but how bigger you are doing. If you are getting a much of a wide space, you crop it and then you zoom into the normal India map. This is the fourth attribute, project for string. The project for string is, for example, the thing is that normally if you see a map of a world or maybe India, it's a spherical, it's a definitely a projection. So you have a spherical surface, the earth is a spherical, it's divided into latitudes and longitudes, But to project it in onto XY coordinates, we need to have some projection parameters. So in this, this project for a string gives us the projection parameters that on what scale are we projecting on a 2D scale. So we have a 3D view of the world, it is being projected onto a 2D scale. That's where this project for string comes. If you notice that states has a type S4, so it's a class object. The thing is that in R, you have S4 class and you divide those attributes and the kind of data in a single stack. So I will be having data separately, I will be having polygons to state my shapefile, and project for string is the mapping part. So the three important things are data, what the attributes it represents, polygons, what is my shapefile, and the project map, the projection attributes. So that was the basic loading of the data. Then if you notice that we are using read_ogr function, the read_ogr function is available from RG Dell library. Yeah. So if you notice that the read_ogr function in the older versions, they had some we had to specify that the shapefile is what and the, but there has been upgrades made. So using this read_ogr function, it's directly all you need to is shapefile. It will load everything automatically. It just need to be in the same folder. So read, RGDEL is a library. So normal traditional GIS softwares use GeoData Abstraction Library. It's for reading the vector and the raster data. So it's just R interface to the GeoData Abstraction Library. So next we will take a look. So we have taken a look at the slots. These are the slots. So as I have specified that it are just classes and the subclasses sort of a thing. So we have data as a separate thing. Then we will just plot these slots. Let's just run this. Plot the states. It gives me the normal shapefile of India. So that is the initial part. I am taking what is the class of state name. So because R also has a factor attribute. If you load by default, it will load as a factor. So if you go back, I have specified explicitly that read as string factors as false. So factors is leveling of the data. So for example, in R, if you have a three attributes like high, low, or medium, so I can define it as a three levels. I can define my categories in three, read, high, low, or medium. But the thing would be I can order them. But I don't want in this case. Hence, I just need to make sure that it's in the character thing. So just a small demonstration purpose, I will just select those names with the all those states which have a starting character as A. I am using the subsetting function. Those who are aware with Python, they will know that subsetting work. Data is my attributes file. I just subset all those states name which have a starting character as A. So these are the four states, and let's just plot this. So I have selected this selection in this, I think this selection will select those states names with A, and then plotting of the states will come. So if you note, I have just selected the boundaries of those states. So Assam, Arunachal Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, these are just the boundaries of the states with the starting name A. So next I want to look at in the respect with the India map. So I will just run this. So it plots the states with the background color gray. Then I select it. Then I, using this add is equal to true argument and the color is equal to blue, I'm highlighting those states which have a state's name starting with A. So this is just for a simple demonstration purpose, or for you, you can also have a census data, and I want to select those data which have a population say greater than 50,000 lakhs. So you can specify that in the subsetting function, and you can highlight it with the background of the India map. For the next section, I need to make sure that my CRS arguments, which is called coordinate referential system, need to be in accordance with what I am planning to see. So I am using WGS coordinate system, which is a world geographic special reference. And there is also EPSG reference system. So these are WGS is accepted worldwide. EPSG is just another, you can use this repository link to see what EPSG is all about. So I'm using British National Grid coordinate reference system for my map. So I have all my coordinates, all my mapping projected according to British National Grid coordinate reference system. So next we will just see ArcGIS library. So ArcGIS library is all about manipulating the data. So I have a vector data. I need to see how different it is from latitude, how far it is from longitude. So it is all because of the centroid. So in this part, I will be making a map. I will just show the map first. So this is India map. I have highlighted those zones which lie in the buffer region of 2 degrees from the Delhi. So this is also useful, like if you have some outbreak of a disease in a country and I want to highlight the centroid of that nature. So it is, let's say, 2 kilometers far wide from that centroid. I need to highlight those states, and just for not allowing it to spread it further, these features are useful. So for demonstration purpose, I'm keeping everything as a simple thing. It can be extended to, like, it's all about you, how do you use it. So in this thing, we will first use the gcentroid function from ArcGIS library. I want the centroid from the NCT of Delhi. So note that in my shapefile, I had Delhi as NCT of Delhi, it's not as a normal Delhi. And it will get my centroid here. I want to plot the points which are at the distance of CX, plot the points of centroid of Delhi of size 3. I will set the 2 degree buffer here, width 2 degree, and use this SP geometry, special geometry of central Delhi buffer. So it will create a buffer around the Delhi of 2 degree, and then we will select states which lies in this Delhi buffer or which intersect with this Delhi buffer, and we will call it as Delhi Central, and we will color it as light blue. So next we will just add the border and we will have this map as the our analysis. For the next part, what I am going to do is this is where the actual essence of R comes into the picture. I have a data of shapefile which is not having much of a data, it's just having the state names and you can all see it. But for this next part, I have a data from government data site which involves the road accidents data. So it was provided from year 2014 to 2017, and it is a non-spatial data. So we will first plot it on a simple histogram, so point plots using ggplot library. And these are just the names. So let's just prepare the data for this analysis part. So in this case, I'm reading this road accidents data. If you want to have a look, then I can do it. But just, OK, I also have here. OK, wait. Yeah, so this is the data which I had. The state name, the number of accidents and people injured in 2014, then 2015. So I have a huge data for that. I need to trim it for my purpose. And I will use it using the R special libraries to plot it on the maps. So let me just zoom into the source first. OK, just leave it. So accidents we have read. So now, next, we will join the data. It's accident states, union territories, and which are the states. So first, before joining the data, we need to make sure that the variables' names are same. So in this case, I'm selecting the states, union territories, which are not in the state name. And next, I'm selecting the state names which are not in state union territories. So it will give me discrepancies from both the data sets. So if I have, like here, we have Delhi, which is not in our shape file. And so the first four results are from my actual government data sites. The next four results are from my shapefile. So Delhi mismatches with NCT of Delhi. Dadra and Nagar Haveli is just a typographical error. Arunachal Pradesh, Andaman, Nicobar Islands are just CS is different. So this is just a typographical error, and we will just edit it using this method. So this edit will open a window like this, and I have already run it. So it's correct in this place, islands, Arunachal Pradesh. If you go Dadra and Nagar Haveli, and Delhi is also corrected. So because I have already run it, I have created it, and if I want, I can just go and type here. So I will not change the data because it will affect the future results might be. So just to bring the consistency between the two data frames. So now I am doing inner join. Inner join is data and accidents by state name and state union territory, which is a name, a state's name in the my accidents data file. Then we will, so now my data is prepared. I will go with the plotting function. So first selects the accidents data frame. I'm selecting only the columns 1 to 5 because I'm only interested in the number of people injured in India. Then I want to clear the row name, header, column names. To year only. So accidents I have selected in this case, just see this is what I will be getting. The state name, year, number of people injured in the states. So I have sub-selected what the information I need for my representation purpose. So before we go ahead, it will create a pivot longer. So this is what it does. It does accident df.m. If I just have a look at this, I think it's 3 variable only. Yeah, so here we have state name, year. So what I'm doing is I have 4-5 columns and multiple columns. I'm creating it and pivoting around the year so that my state name, year, and person injured tuple is there. So I will having only 3 columns in this case. So then you will have pivot longer is used for that only. We are tidying the purpose. So while you do the tidy, while you call this pivot longer function, it removes the attributes which you have joined from the accidents data. So we also need to combine it. So just the thing is that with all these parts comes with the after we have prepared and df.m is prepared. We will again select all those states with starting a letter M. I'm not doing special analytics right now also because I'm just wanted to display that not all the states data can be plotted on a single page. And this just a one small aspect of why we are using R with a special. Its use case is very, very large. We can use, like in the later part of the tutorial, we are able to calculate the home range and latitude longitude information to identify the house sales and how different houses are apart, or maybe a center of a city is much more crowded with the houses than the far off part of the city. So it's very much later in the part. I will leave it in the document and probably will not be able to cover it in the given time. So just very much introduction. So this is what the plot we have. So Madhya Pradesh has more than 40,000 of accidents, Maharashtra around 40,000. And so even this small map could not be accommodated clearly. So I cannot have much details about the variant between how my states are progressing. So we'll look and get more details from the spatial part. So ggmap is laid over the ggplot2 package, and it allows us to get the all the attributes and in, on a spatial map only. So we have a tidy function that also coerces the spatial object into a data frame object, and it will like lose the attribute information of the states object. So that's why we need to create some IDs and again create the data from our spatial data like states, which is a shape file, and then recombine it with the accidents data. So why we are using a tidy function is because if you remember, the states file doesn't had separated this data polygons and project first strings. It doesn't have the latitude longitude information. So for ggmap, I need to have the latitude longitude information. So it's a spatial object, not a data frame. So I need to see it in the data frame object for the plot purpose. So I will see if I had states data frame. So if you see that it has like 1,40,000 14,38,000 observations and 28 variables with the longitude and latitude information. So that's what my tidy function does. It just coerces the data from a spatial object to a data frame. Then you have a, because when you coerce, it loses the attribute information. So I need to add the attribute information again from the states data to states df from the states data part. Then we will go with the plotting purpose. That is the simplest thing now. So data, AES is the aesthetic. So I am plotting x is longitude and y is latitude. Then grouping of the data, fill according to this year and polygon, latitude, longitude, number of persons injured. And this is what I get in the road accidents for India. For I'm currently selecting for the year 2015 only. So if you see this India map, we have much more inferences now that the southern India, or maybe from Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, have the highest number of persons injured in these states are more than as compared to other states. So the darker the green color, the Tamil Nadu is the much more accident prone area, and the number of persons injured in Tamil Nadu is more. So if I want to add some more variables, I can use this GGSN library, and that is the beauty of R. You can add more features to a single plot function. So plot is like polymorphed function, and it's using the states file. So states is my special object. Data frame is a different. So before I use plot, I was getting those point plot, scatter plot. Now I'm using a map function. So that is the beauty of R. I can use that same plot function for different purposes. I just need to be sure what I'm using it for. So next, I will form a wrapping of the function. So here I am using, I just used some libraries and created a facet wrap of this, and I couldn't see any differences in the number of persons injured in the accident. So maybe 4 years is less amount of data. The government has provided less amount of data, and that is a key feature of any special M. We need to have more data. So if I had more data, we can have much more inferences about how the year, over the years, the number of accidents are happening in city, in a state, in India. The other library I will be looking is at TMAP. So why we are using TMAP is because it gives us much more information. So all these packages, GGMAP, TMAP, all these packages are mapping functions, and they gives us much more handling of the data in a different perspective. So TMAP is again a better version which avoids the limitations of the GGMAP thing. Then again, we will load the shapefile. So in this tutorial, I think I do have a time. Okay, 15 minutes also, half an hour around. So I have those shapefiles. In this case, we are this is a shapefile. So I have used this shapefile from a London district. So Camden is a district in London, and I have a census data. So I will just open shapefile of this, maybe not on the graph. I will have, so this is my shapefile. If its boundaries and all these polygons are my shapefile, and we will plot it accordingly. So we have a census data for the Camden area, and we will coerce it, we will combine it with these output areas, and by some parameters I have used it. So you need to be very much aware about how the shapefile is looking at, and on what parameters I want to join it. So these are just the variable names on which I have joined. So in output area in Camden is reference is this OA11CD, and in the my other census data it is referenced as OA. So I'm just joining it on that. Then we will create a TMAP. So if you can see, all I have is TMAP. Quick TMAP is a quick plotting function. OA census fill according to qualification. So before I go and see what all we have in data of the Camden. So this is my census data, OA. Number of British people, white British in output area. Are they occupying low occupancy? They are occupying less area. Are they employed or unemployed? This is in percentage. So unemployed percentage is about 2% in this output area. And this output area is need to be referenced from my shapefile, that which output area it refers to. And qualification is round about, say, how many people have qualified A-level or O-level in UK. So 73% of the population has qualified A-level in this case. So here we will just fill according to the qualification. So if you can see that 60 to 80 qualification, much of my map is occupied with the 60 to 80% of population, then followed by 40 to 60. I can say that majority of population is more than more qualified than 40% is qualified. So this is all this about. I can also draw the similar maps on the unemployed percentage and the this white British occupancy, low white British percentage and low occupancy. I can just change the variable names here. Let me just do it for you once, unemployed. So, yeah, not majority of population. So in here I can see not majority of population is unemployed. I mean, maximum is 20%. So that is a good thing about R. I can use different data sets, different data frames, and just combine it and get a map figure also. So next I have discussed about how I can give much more details to this maps. So I'm using this TM shape OS census qualification. Palette is for this growing. I just need only yellow, orange, and red color and adding a north arrow. So I also have a histogram below. This histogram is like equality distribution, like a majority of my like 60 to 80 are more than 40, as I said. So it's all about QTM function and QTM library. Next, in the amount of time we have, 10 minutes special analysis in R. Next, we will do house sales, download the house sales. So house sales, I just need to have. So this data is provided again from this CDRC website, and I will house sales.shape file. I will again not go back into and browse it again. I will just see how it is look. So just let me add one more line. So I need, that's why this is the thing is, because it needs to be running from top to bottom. It's a scripting kind of a language, so I need to load this read.ogr function, and library is this. Let me just try this. Yep. So this is all my shapefile consists. It consists of points, if you note. It all consists of the house sale points and not more. So that's why, okay, this is also one of the data I am having, this, number of sales in a Camden, house sales. So next we will go with the following kernel density estimation for the Camden data. I have use the library raster for rasterizing the data because I want a continuous plot in this case. Add habitat provides me direct functions for kernel density estimation, and in this case I am getting the output. I'm using kernel density estimate for house dot points, and grid is 1000. So these all details are needed to be are part of the spatial spatial field only. So I'm referring, I'm restricting to R and spatial data, and this library can, you can go and reference and go in much more detail what all this reference to. So I have this density estimation. I use the library directly, and you have this sort of a plot, some point of some blue areas, some red areas. So we will see what it is all about. Now we will convert it to a raster object and set the projection again, and then shape file. And this is how it is looking on our Camden area. So some points of very low magnitude and high. And if you notice, this very large big part is my boundary box in this case. So I will trim it further. Boundary box, I will set the boundary box. And I will zoom into it. So some areas are much more where house sales are higher. Some areas just a little lower. So these are the amount of house sales in this case. It's still not a clear picture because I don't have the boundaries. So next I will add the shapefile. Masking of this shapefile, and we will have a quantile region, so like 25% and 50%. So now I have a better picture, but still my objective is not clear. I wanted to calculate the amount of house sales in a region is concentrated, is much more dense. So this darker the region, it is much more denser. The house sales is denser in this part. The outer part will have a lesser number of house sales, because that's much more of a northern area and it's much more cold there. So you can expect that the house sales are not much more there. So we'll calculate the 10% range, 25% range, 50% range, and 75% range in this vertex share. And home ranges is just for, this term is from the animal kingdom. So if you want to, calculate like how many varieties or species of animals are there in an animal kingdom, we'll use the home ranges function. And similarly, in this case, we are just separating the house sales from each other. So if I have some house sales, so let's just plot it and see. So this is my final plot. This is final analysis. So if you can see, this area has higher house sales number. This is sparsely located. This is again higher. You can see overlapping of the points. Little more sparse. As we go more and more sparse occupancy of house sales, and at the far off, we don't have much of the house sales there. So, okay, I will just refer to the references which I have used. It is an ebook in specializing data, and some other practicals are there. I have used this Brunson C and Comberell, which provide much more detail and much more analytics part for the spatial data. So the Camden house sale is just part of that only. I have reproduced it because it was much easy for pedagogical reasons. And hence, these are the only four references, which I think is much more concise and much more detailed. So at the last, I would like to thank you all for being such a wonderful audience.